Jesus himself spoke that word. And ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, the disciples of Christ prayed with great expectation, awaiting the coming promise of power. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing, mighty wind, and it filled the house where they were sitting. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. The people that day marveled, and asked, "What does this mean?" Then Peter lifted up his voice and declared, "This is that song." That was spoken by the prophet Joel. These were the first of the last days. This is that Jesus promised to empower his chosen disciples to go into all the world and preach the gospel. That same experience has swept through the centuries, nearly 1900 years later. Preachers began boldly proclaiming tongues as the initial evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Thousands of joined the ranks of the Jesus Christ to witness the miracles, signs, and wonders. After the constant phenomenon was felt to roam the streets of Indianapolis, as in late 1880 began proclaiming the promise of the Spirit baptism. It was a wicked. The church has survived the onslaught of history. What once was experienced in an upper room, since revival meetings, convention halls, and basketball arenas, has now moved into a new realm.
We should be in football stadiums, not basketball courts!
This is all possible because of that which was prophesied. Youth Congress is a sign that miracles and wonders are here.
When an event becomes a movement. But I think North American Youth Congress is on the cusp of making a transition from being an event to becoming a movement.
At the stars. You are living in the midst of that prophecy. God is pouring out His Spirit on all flesh, using teenagers and young adults to turn His divine plan. It's not just somewhere or sometime. It's here and now. You are declaring the gospel in classrooms and campuses all across North America, boarding planes and landing at destinations around the globe to share the news. We are approaching the day of mission where we'll be preaching the gospel in every nation that we have. Their mission is our mission. We have been given that same power to go and serve, and we're more empowered by the Spirit. You too become a part of the promise. What you do in your local church where nobody is watching is as valuable to the kingdom as ministering to tens of thousands in the football stadium where everybody is watching. This is all possible because you are faithful to serve your friends and family, the hurting and the broken. This is possible because you sacrificially give, enabling the message of Christ to come to the earth. This is all possible because God's Spirit is alive in you. Your faith works. What you do in your community works for the kingdom. Be empowered by the Spirit. This is your opportunity. This is your time to stand up and speak up. You are propelled with the power of prophetic promise. You are standing in the evidence of the power of God. This is that fulfillment of prophecy. You are the chosen generation. This is that.
You hear me when I call on you. Lord. First, I'd like to thank Brother Gordon and Pastor Kelley for letting me do this fire starter tonight. I'd like to open up tonight at Luke 18, 1 through 8. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint, saying there was in a city a judge, which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came unto him, saying, Avenge me of my advisory. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, Though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet but this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she wear me. And the Lord said, Hear what the unjust judge said. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth. Tonight, I'd like to talk to you on the waiting room of life. How many like to wait? I mean, it's hard to wait in a long line in Walmart. You understand, don't you? You only have a few items in there, and two or three people ahead looks like they just bought enough for a year, and all the other lines are full. Sometimes you're tempted to put things back on the shelf and come back later when the line is down. It seems like they never have enough checkouts when I'm in a hurry. Waiting in traffic while you're in a hurry is hard. Notice verse 1 from several different translations. The New Living Translation says, One day, Jesus told his disciples a story to show that they should always pray and never give up. The Message version says, Jesus told them a story showing that it was necessary for them to pray consistently and never quit. And the New Century version says, Then Jesus used this story to teach his followers that they should always pray and never lose hope. As we look at this parable, try to see it in its Easter setting. The courtroom was not a fine building, but a tent that was moved from place to place as the judge covered his circuit. The judge, not the law, set the agenda, and he sat regularly in the tent surrounded by his assistants. Anybody could watch the proceedings from the outside, but only those who were approved and accepted could have their cases tried. This usually meant bribing one of the assistants so that he would call the judge's attention to the case. The widow had three obstacles overcome. First, being a woman, she therefore had little standing before the law. In the Palestinian society of the Lord's day, women do not go to court. Since she was a widow, she had no husband to stand with her in court. Finally, she was poor and could not pray a bribe, even if she wanted to. No wonder poor widows do not always get the protection the law was supposed to afford them. You should always pray. The antidote to despair is not determination, but dependence, not positive thinking. But prayer. This phase, should always pray, doesn't say it quite strongly enough. Prayer is something we are permitted to do if we please. The word should could be translated to must. They must always pray and not give up. Prayer is what we commanded to do as God's will. The New Living Translation of Philippians 4 and 6 says, Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need. Notice the words anything and everything. Work like it depends on you. Pray like it depends on God.
Right.
Four simple ways to communicate with God. Talk to God with a gut level honesty. You don't have to pray God in the King James Version language, nothing like that. Just talk to him. You don't have to babble on and on. Talk to God about everything that matters to you. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 through 18, New Century Version says, Always be joyful. Pray continually and give thanks whatever happens. This is what God wants you to do. This is what God wants for you in Jesus Christ. Does that mean our time must be spent on nothing but prayer? No, but it does mean that we must do nothing without prayer. It does mean to make a prayer as natural to us as our regular breathing. Unless we were sick or something, we rarely think about our breathing. We just do it likewise with prayer. It should be the natural habit of our lives, the atmosphere in which we constantly live. Take some time to listen to his response. It's not a one-way conversation. And the second thing is never give up. One day, Jesus told his disciples a story to show that they should always pray and never give up. During World War II, Oxford University asked Prime Minister Winston Churchill to address its commencement exercise. Dressed in his finest suit, he arrived in the auditorium where the service was to be held with his unusual props, a cigar, a cane, and a topper. As Churchill approached the podium, the crowd rose in appreciative applause. Standing there looking very dignified, he settled the crowd down and asked them to be seated. Standing confidently before the crowd of great admirers, he removed his cigar and placed his top hat on the podium. Then Churchill gazed at his waiting audience that included some of the most noted scholars in the world. With an authoritative tone in his voice, he began with these three words, "Never give up." Several seconds passed without him saying another word. Finally, he repeated those same three words again, "Never give up." There was a deafening silence as Churchill reached for his hat and cigar, steadied himself with the cane, and left the platform. His commencement address was finished. Let me just say, no matter what's going on in your life now, or has been going on in your life, you don't have to give up. No matter how hard it is, never give up. Let these three words sink into your spirit. The word faith describes a believer who loses heart and gets discouraged that he or she wants to quit. Prayer puts us in touch with the pure oxygen of heaven so that we can keep going. The word push, I broke it down into the four letters. P stands for pray, U stands for until, S stands for something, and H stands for happens, which comes out of being prayer, pray until something happens. Many times we are tempted to throw in the towel. Maybe you have seen an injustice and want to give up. The widow represents the depth of helplessness, and weakness. As a woman in a biased society, she has almost no political clout. As a widow in that time, she almost certainly knows dire poverty. The death of her husband was left her without an advocate or a protector, and some unscrupulous individual has exploited her weakness. Justice may be on her side, but she has no witness with which to fight. She is helpless before an indifferent judge. All she has on her side is a stubborn determination to get what is coming to her. She hounds the judge until he can't stand the side of her. Persistence was her only resource, and finally she strikes pay dirt. The judge concludes, in effect, "I don't care about God's law or people's opinions, but this woman is wearing me out. If I give her what she wants, then she'll leave me alone." He has no interest in her. He has no interest in either justice of woman's rights. Yet he acts on her behalf. So a powerless woman with no weapon but persistence and perseverance receives her right from an evil judge. How do we keep from quitting? Get the right perspective on who God is. Luke 18, 6 and 7, New Living Translation says, "Then the Lord said, 'Learn a lesson from this unjust judge. Even he rendered a just decision in the end.'" So don't you think God will surely give justice to his chosen people who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? This is a contrasting prayer. God is not like the judge. He wants to bless you with good gifts. He does not need to be nagged or manipulated into acting on our behalf. His care for our needs is not generated by us wearing him out with our request. He is generous with his gifts, and he wants to bless us. If a helpless widow who had no weapon but her persistence could get her way with a hard-hearted, unjust judge, how much more will God's people receive what they need from the gracious Father? One of the best things ever invented on the phone is a caller ID. When the phone rings and the name of the individual or a company appears on your caller ID, you have a choice to answer it or ignore it. When he sees your phone, when he sees your name on the caller ID, he drops everything he is doing just to listen to you. Remember that God's timing is always perfect. Luke 11 and 9 says, "And so I tell you, keep on asking, and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking, and you will find. Keep on knocking, and the door will be open to you." Don't give up on your dreams, desires, etc. Just pray until something happens.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Awesome job, Brother Austin. Give him a big hand on your team. What an anointing on his life. When he first started, I had to look over his notes and say, "Austin, you're doing all right. Let me see what you got. Let me see how you're prepared." And he had a page. I said, "All right, that's a good start." And now as he gets comfortable in preaching up here, I saw him moving those pages across, and I said, "Well, I guess he's developing pretty well." I would say, "A great, great job, Brother Austin. Very good." It's not easy up here speaking to wonderful saints like you, but you guys back him up, and I appreciate that so very, very much. Got a couple of announcements as our ushers make their way forward. Please remember Friends Day. We had a challenge that was issued towards the blue team and the red team. All right, we represent tonight. Big Red, are you in the building? Baby Blues, are you in the building? Hey man, we're going to do our very best to make 250. I believe that we can do that in Jesus' name, amen. Anybody really believe that, Pastor?
I believe it. I was going to say this in case I forget at the end of the service. After the service tonight, we did a calling post. We're doing celebrating Brother and Sister Gordon's birthday. Everybody make plans to stay and have a great time of fellowship. Some people thought it might be for Trey, but we've already celebrated too much of Trey. We're waiting until he leaves, and we're going to throw a party after he's gone. But tonight is for the Gordons, and we love and appreciate our assistant pastor and his wife and great things to minister to us. Amen. So stay, and if you brought a card, that'd be great. If you forgot something, they'll take it later on. So God bless you for your kindness.
Thank you so much. I love it, Pastor Kelley. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Just a couple of announcements. Friends Day of the end of the month, Sunday. I got onto the cake thing and it just threw me off. And so we kind of regrouped. August the 27th, we'll have Friends Day. Invite someone. Pastor's pushing 250. I believe that we can do it by the help of God. And so if you can, invite as many people as you can. I told Mama Kelley today, I said, "You got all those kids, you better bring them that day, because you sit right over here on the winning team." So we want to make sure that happens. So we have cards that we're going to pass out this morning that we did, so we have plenty more to give out if you want to give to your neighbor, a friend, or a co-worker. So we want to make sure that the news is spread and that we have a great, great time. Got a couple of prayer requests here this evening. Want to remember Sister Faith, last couple of weeks, days scheduled for her baby, and so we're just looking forward to seeing that little bundle of joy, amen? And so we're asking you to pray for them, pray for Brother Smith, Sister Smith, also Sister Betty Burgess. Burgess is in St. Thomas, Rutherford, room 462, and Brother Hunter has back pain. Please remember that need as well. If you have a need, by the uplifting of your hand, would you do that and make it known to the Lord Jesus? And I believe that God is going to answer, minister, and do whatever he needs to do to take care of our needs. God is a healer. You believe that God is a healer. I believe God is a way maker. And I think and I know that God will make a way where there seems to be no way. In the beginning of the service, we had a video presented by the General Youth Division on North American Youth Congress. It was a very, very awesome and wonderful experience. We had 13 students attend that, including my wife and I, which made 15. So we had a wonderful, wonderful time. We asked them to take pictures throughout the week and the services and all of the time that they had, and just collected all of those, and we put it all together in a video presentation. And I hope you guys enjoy it. We're going to have a good time. So at this time, as you give into the offering, because we are cheerful givers, according to this morning's sermon. Amen? We're cheerful givers, and so we're going to give to the kingdom of the Lord as the video plays, in Jesus' name. God bless you.
North American Youth Congress is on the cusp of making a transition from meeting an event to becoming a movement.
Thank you.
video, over 34,000 young adults, teenagers, were worshiping the one true living God. Come on, I believe that we are in a movement like no other. I'm glad to be apostolic today. I'm glad to be one of God, Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized. I'm glad to know that my Savior and Redeemer lives inside of me. I don't know if I'm talking to anybody, but I want to let you know that we serve a great, big God. I wonder if we can stand to our feet and rejoice that we have a loving Savior, a Redeemer, a way maker. Come on, we serve a great God. We serve a wonderful God. We serve a wonderful, great, big God. This is that. Is this that?
This is that.
This is that. Nearly 34,000 students, and among those 34,000 students were 13 wonderful apostolic young people right here from their lives. Come on, give them a big hand. Come on, give them a big hand. We're going to join you on the stage just for a moment. If you went to North American Youth Congress, I want you to join me right behind me. And they're going to give, a few of them will give some testimonies of what God has done in their life. We're going to start off with Colin. I'm just kidding. I told him, I said, if you don't want to speak, you don't have to speak. I told Corey, I said, Corey, I said, if you want to speak, it's okay, you can speak. No, I won't speak. I said, what happened if the Lord moves on you and you felt led? I don't want to, you know, get in the way. He goes, no, you won't be in the way. Right. So they're going to give just a couple of seconds of what God has done for them. As you saw in the video, God was just pouring out his blessing. And it was just wonderful to see our students just giving God everything, giving God worship. And it was just a sight to see, an incredible, incredible atmosphere. So I'll get out of the way. Sister Erica wanted to speak first because she thought other people were going to steal her story. But everybody has a unique story in itself. And so we'll start with her, and then I'll start calling out some people. Like a prophet, I'll just start it. No, I'm just kidding. Sister Erica, come up here and speak to them.
Well, as everyone knows, it's a life-changing experience. And there's really no words that you can describe it with. You just have to be there. And since I have a lot of stories, there's a lot of stories. That's why I wanted to go first, so I can claim these stories. So he was trying to ask that. So one of the stories that was actually told is, I can't remember what night it was, but there was just an outpouring of the Holy Ghost, and people were worshiping and praying for workers and everything. And they were worshiping and praying so much that they asked them to go outside of the arena because everybody could hear them. So when they went out into the arena, they started praying, and there were some workers that were getting off work and stuff, and so they started praying with them. And these are workers, you know, maybe haven't heard of God, or maybe they haven't experienced Pentecost. And so many of them got the Holy Ghost. I don't even remember how many were, but there was one boy that was leaving work, and he had just got fired from his job. And he went over there, and he was praying with these people, and he got the Holy Ghost. And he told the people that he was praying with afterwards that he had been going through so much in his life, and that after they prayed for him and he got the Holy Ghost, he said before they did that, he was planning to go home and kill himself. And they prayed for him and he got the Holy Ghost, and he was asking where a nearby church was, and he was like, I'm ready for this right here. I'm ready for Pentecost. That's what this is for. On the first night, you know, they passed out little bitty bottles of oil for everybody, and they told us to put it on our hands and anoint ourselves. You know, that's what we have to do sometimes. You know, nobody's going to get our blessing for us. Nobody's going to go pray for other people for us. You know, the blessings we get, it's up to us. And that was one of my favorite sermons because it was up to me to get my blessing. I had to anoint myself to do what God has called me to do. And it was an absolutely life-changing experience. I'm so thankful we had so many new ones to go. And it was something that I'm never going to forget. I can't wait till next year. The year after next.
Amazing. Everyone will say that. Just going up there the whole time, getting ready for it, was like, guys, we're about to go to Congress. Like, getting in the car, guys, we're going to Congress. Just 34,000 young people worshiping God is truly amazing. And you don't know what it's like till you're there. Like, pictures and videos, it doesn't do it justice because it's just so amazing. And it's not that, it's not just the building we're in, it's the people we're with that make it awesome. And God just had his hand on us the whole time, from having our hotel and walking distance, which is a big deal, and just everything. But we walked to every service, and that was just so awesome, convenient and everything. But my favorite service was probably the first one when Michael Enzi preached, and he was talking about faith factor and everything, and he said, like, your faith is more important than fear, and like, what would it be like if you traded your fear for faith? And he told us to pray for ourselves, and I still have mine tonight in my room, and it's just so great. And you know, the whole time was so awesome, but the one thing that was a real bummer was when the service, when we was waiting outside to get in, and it was in line, and it started sprinkling. It wasn't a big deal. It's like, okay. And then it just started pouring down rain, and you just automatically just soaked, and it's so awful. Me, Savannah, and Haley walked back to the hotel, which was great, walking distance. And then, but Savannah didn't have her key to the room, so she went in mine and Haley's room, and she had two blow dryers just blow drying her dress. And
this is that for her, so. A little drying hair. Come here, Sister Alexis. I want you to speak. Give it up for Sister Alexis. Now, let me just say this. I want you to raise your hand if this was your first time ever going to Youth Congress. Raise your hand so everybody can see. Nice and, look at that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 out of the 13 first time ever going to Youth Congress. Woo! And it was a life-changing experience for them.
Alexis? So it is my first time, and I've never been around that many people, especially worshiping God. It changed my life. One of my favorite services was, I don't remember who preached it or what his name was, but it was a call of greatness. And that service is just amazing. It really showed me that I do have a call, and the devil will try to tell you that you don't and that it's not your call, but it is.
You saw Dominic the floor and giving his heart and his soul to the Lord. This guy's been through a lot. He's been through a lot, but God has had his hand on him, his favor on him. There's an anointing on this young guy right here. We're very proud of him, what God is doing in his life. He's accepting that calling to preach and to minister and to be a vessel that God can use, and I want him to share his testimony tonight.
Well, before Youth Congress, I was going through some stuff, and while I was at Youth Congress, I was praying to God to help me. To get through it. And after the Youth Congress, he brought me through it. I can't wait to go back.
Hey, brother Austin. This guy right here. I think he kept me awake the entire time. From driving to the hotel. It was one night, he was trying to order pizza, about half asleep, ordering. Didn't realize when the bill came, Mama, that it was $22 for the actual pizza until you saw it on that card. This guy ordered, and he didn't even eat the pizza afterwards. I didn't know if that was a secret or not, but the secret's out. But God had spoken to him, and you saw just as many as the others that he was worshiping and jumping and just giving his all to the Lord, and I want him to share his testimony.
Well, first of all, that pizza wasn't, didn't even taste good. It didn't even taste good.
It's $22.
But Youth Congress was my first time, and it was amazing. I really enjoyed it. Yeah, we were sitting at the restaurant. We were sitting at the Old Spaghetti Factory. I'm sitting, me and Dominic, with my brother Gordon and sister Gordon. I asked for sweet tea, and they come back with just tea. And I taste the tea. My reaction was probably the greatest reaction we had. Drinking that tea, it was not. Man, but I put that sugar in that tea, and I think I put a little bit too much sugar in there. But back on the services, Sam Everett was my favorite preacher. I really liked him. He spoke on the message, is this that, and that's where this and that came from. Or not came from, but that's where he did that, whatever he did. And Victor Jackson Friday night was amazing too. That service we had was one of the greatest services I've had in a while. And then Saturday, Kings Island, I came over my fear of roller coasters. Going up this thing, was sitting beside Dominic, and I was so scared, like this is no joke, I was so scared, I asked Dominic to hold my hand.
That's a true brother right there.
But yeah, King's Island was great, and the services were great, and I really enjoyed conference.
This guy, he
won't speak, but I'm going to speak for him. Lucas, speaking of roller coasters, is not that thrilled of roller coasters, Mama. And so when we got on that ride you saw on there, we had our hands up. He rode with me. I said, Lucas, I said, I had to talk him from the entrance all the way up to the second we sat on that in that car. And I said, Lucas, you're going to be okay. You're with me. I promise you. There is a picture that when you go up the roller coaster, they take a picture when you go down. Mom, listen, we could not find him in the cart in that picture. We searched and searched, and in this little a white speck was Lucas tucked under me, scared to death. But I told him afterwards, I said, man, I am so proud of you, because he was deathly afraid of roller coasters. Listen, these guys have overcome a lot of fear. Fear was not a factor after he pulled that ride, and so I was very, very proud of him. And not just we're having a good time, but not only that, I was very proud of Lucas and Corey and Colin and Elijah. Here, Elijah, you're next. And it was the first time for this guy, and he was the youngest out of all of us, and he stuck with it. He went with the group, he stayed with the group, he hung with the boys, didn't he? Didn't. Until the episode where we saw him sleeping, and that was the first night. So, no, I'm just kidding. That was like second or third. There's only 3 days, so you gotta, you know.
But he had a great time. I want you to let everybody know how awesome Youth Congress was. Can you do that?
Well, it was a really fun experience for me, and the food was good, and the services were good, and I really had a fun time there.
All right, we'll let Mackenzie speak and then we'll pray about Colin.
Okay, so I was not like Brooklyn. I was not prepared for this. I did not write notes, so I'm going to wing it. I've been a part of what was West Side and is now New Life for 16 years, and I've always heard people talking about Youth Congress, it's so fun, and I'm like, okay, when I get old enough, I'm gonna go. Went this year. Thank you, Jeremy. It was great, it was a life-changing event, and it was just great to know that I can look up, down, left, right, and see more Pentecostals beside me and across from me that were that were worshiping with the Lord and that love the Lord as much as I do. It was just great. I'm going to tell a story about our little experience in the hotel. So we decide one night we want pizza. We did not think this through, first of all. And my roommate, Alexis, she decides we're going to call Domino's. Okay, they're great. We called them at like 11:30, asked them for a pizza. It did not get at the hotel until 1:30 in the morning. So we did not get to eat dinner until 1:30, did not go to bed until 3. So, and it didn't really help that she called and asked where the pizza was. So needless to say, if you are ever in a city where you know there are 34,000 other people, don't call Domino's.
You could order room service and pay $22 like Austin did.
Sessions in the morning, and they were just as excited as they were the night before.
Listen, I'm very proud of these students. Absolutely, absolutely proud. And I want to thank all of the parents who entrust Sister Gordon and I to train them, to equip them, to instill something of God's kingdom in them. And I'm very thankful for that opportunity. I don't ever take it for granted, because these are our next generation of missionaries and preachers and teachers and witness, or people who are going to go out of these four walls and do something great for the kingdom of God. We're going to let Trey preach here today, so we're going to stand and get right into the word. I'm ready to hear some good word from a good man by the name of Trey Kelley. Thank you, students. Lucas, you wanted to say something? I'm going to get back in my cave. Amen. No, I didn't forget him. He's all right. Listen, we want to pray for Brother Trey. This is his last service, of course, and he goes to college to Urshan this week. They leave on Tuesday, and we want the Lord just to be with him throughout his time there, his season. I believe God is going to anoint him tremendously, even be above and beyond what God is doing with him here at our local church. Aren't you proud of Trey? Trey, I want you to preach your heart to us today. This is his last service. Let's get behind him. Let's get with him. And let's preach behind him and let him know that we appreciate him and love him. One more time, would you put your hands together?
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. You can be seated. Since Brother Gordon didn't let me testify, I guess I'll talk about a little bit about Youth Congress. This was my sixth Youth Congress, I think, and it's gotten better and better every time. And the first night, when Brother Enzi had all of us anoint our own heads with oil, I had this girl came up, never seen her before in my life, came up and spoke a word into my life. Spoke right exactly what I needed to hear. And, you know, she was pretty cute. I ain't gonna lie. And I was gonna talk to her after I got done praying. But when I got done praying, Austin comes up and hugs me. And when he lets go, the girl's gone. I never saw her again. But that's about all I gotta say. But if you would turn with me to Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 16. First of all, I'm gonna say thank you to Brother Gordon for allowing me to stand behind this pulpit. It's truly an honor. Matthew 5 and 13 says, "Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set upon a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven." For just a little while, I want to talk on a topic. I'll be the one. You can be seated. Sir Nicholas Winton lived from 1909 to 2015. His story begins in 1938 in London, England, where he was just a stockbroker enjoying the good life. The son of German Jewish immigrants, he had been following the rise of Hitler and the Nazis and became convinced that war was imminent. Hitler's troops had just marched into Czechoslovakia and created the war's first concentration camp. At least 150,000 people were held in this one camp. Efforts by different organizations tried to help the people, but were hampered by the fact that most of the European countries didn't want to take the refugees in. Parents were frantically trying to get their children out, so Winton decided to focus his efforts on helping the children in that camp. He had no experience on how to deal with this situation, but was about to take on the Nazis and the British government in a remarkable feat of skill and determination. During the few days he was there, Winton laid the groundwork for a fake organization to transport children to Britain in trains. Meanwhile, he looked for families to take the children in. Everything finally came together on March 14th, 1939, when the first train left carrying 20 children. Six more left between March and August of that year. Because of this one man, over 700 children were spared and able to have families of their own. Today, over 6,000 people are alive who wouldn't be if it wasn't for this one man willing to step out by faith and make a difference. You know, I'm sure fear was present the whole time when was doing this, but as Brother Enzi said in the first night of Congress, he didn't let fear become a factor. I'm sure he was scared out of his mind, but he didn't let that stop him. He didn't let fear get in the way, because if he wasn't going to make a difference, then who would? Who would have the type of faith to step up against not only the Nazis and Hitler, but against the British government? Some of us have been running from our calling for too long because we let fear become a factor. It's been on your hearts to start a P7 club in your school or to invite that one friend to church, but you're not willing to do it because you don't want to be looked at differently or because you're afraid that they'll say the two-letter word that none of us want to hear. A few weeks ago, Pastor preached about the topic, I Can. And yes, you can start a P7 club. You can make a difference in your school. And God will be with you every step of the way. But the truth of the matter is, you can't do it if you won't do it. If you never take that first step, you will never do it. You will never see, you will never reap the harvest. We come in service after service, week after week, sitting on our pew. But why do we keep sitting here when they're calling from out there? I'm not talking about being a missionary to a country halfway around the world. While that may be the call for some of you, I'm talking about the distance it takes to go next door or to walk to your coworker's desk and give a word that brings freedom and hope. The thing is, we never go alone, even if we feel that we're all by ourselves. God is always right there. The God of the universe, the master and creator of everything, knows exactly where you are. You don't have to be bound by fear because God called you to go fearlessly. He's calling out to you. He's calling for you to take that step. He's not looking for your talent or abilities. He's looking for godly confidence in men and women who aren't ashamed. He wants you and he wants me and he needs us now. But you only go as far as your faith will allow. Don't let inadequacy erase the mercy you've been given, nor let fear quench the call that God has placed on your life, because the power of your testimony remains dormant until you open your mouth. No one will ever hear your testimony. You will never have the chance to change a life if you never speak up. You know, I know that school has started up for everyone the past few weeks, and for all of you that are starting middle school and high school, over the next 4 to 6 years, you're going to see and hear about the things that your friends have done and are doing. Trust me, I've stayed up late at many nights just crying over, why do they do these things? But that doesn't mean you look at them any different. That doesn't mean you stop loving them. But listen to me, that doesn't mean you have to take part in what they're doing. Sometimes you won't understand why they do the things they do, but it's also the other way around. They don't understand why you're always coming to church. They don't understand why you dedicate your life to God. My greatest testimony throughout high school was not that God delivered me from alcohol, drugs, and other things, but that he kept me from those things. He protected me. Yes, there were times when I was at places hanging out, and I just had to leave because they started doing things that would destroy my walk with God. Yes, it was awkward. Yes, I was embarrassed, but we're talking about eternity here. You should have the mindset that I don't want to put my eternal destiny on the line. I don't want to give up eternity for a short season of participating in worldly pleasures. Because you're called to a higher standard. You're called to make a difference and to be different and set apart. 1 Timothy 4:12 says, let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. It doesn't matter how old we are. We need to be willing to say, I'll be the one to teach that Bible study. I'll be the one to clean the church. I'll be the one to go lay hands on the sick. If you would put that first picture up there. I don't think I've ever told this story about my trip to Madagascar. But a girl from my trip, her name was Abigail. During a street service, she felt led to go pray for this elderly man, you see. She's probably around 19 years old and always wears hats. I don't know why, but everywhere went, she wore a hat. But as she began praying for him, some others, including me, went and laid hands on him too. When we got done praying, he looked at Abigail and said he loved her blue hat. You know, nothing real big. She just politely said thank you and didn't really think anything of it. A few minutes later, we found out that man said that because when he came to the service, he was completely blind. And Abigail's hat was the first thing he saw when God revealed it to him. Don't ever let the devil tell you that you're too young. Because a teenager laid hands on a blind man and he received his sight. She was willing to be used by God in that moment. You know, I know you've learned a lot about Youth Congress tonight. But 34,000 young people changed the city of Indianapolis forever. And I truly believe that. And in 2015, Brother Anthony Trimble was diagnosed. If you put that next picture up there. He was diagnosed with stage 4 colon cancer. The surgeon would not touch him because he didn't feel like it would be productive. He went through 10 months of chemotherapy. And after that, they said that the chemo couldn't do any more. It was just a matter of time. But the church began to pray. I remember at Congress in 2015, a few months after he was diagnosed, we had special prayer for him. And this past May, he had a colonoscopy before surgery, and they could not find the tumor. I said, they could not find the tumor. This is going to trouble. Give his testimony in front of 34,000 people, and seeing the words, I'm standing here only because you made a way. Don't tell me that God doesn't heal.
Many of us know the story of Moses. When I began studying about him, I found out that Moses, in the Egyptian language, means kid. That's it. Why would the Pharaoh's daughter name him kid? That's like Faith and Jacob naming their newborn baby kid. I mean, I know there's crazy names, but why would you name a kid kid? That's just weird. But when I looked into it deeper, as Moses grew up in the palace, God had something great in store for him. When Moses encountered the burning bush, it was on fire but not consumed by the flames. This is where Moses was called to deliver the Israelites out of Egypt and into Canaan. The name Moses in the Hebrew tongue, though, simply means deliverer. That's it. It means deliverer. In Egypt, Moses means kid, but in Hebrew, it means deliverer. The devil wants you to believe that you can be nothing but a kid. You can never do anything for the kingdom, but I'm here to let you know that God has something more for you. He has something more than just you sitting on a pew. And right now, I want to open these altars for anyone who wants to say, Lord, I'll be the one. I'll be the one who steps out. I'll be the one who wants to make a difference. I'll be the one who desires to see lives change. I'll be the one who wants to see revival happen in this church. Because we're not waiting on God to send revival. It's already here. You just got to be willing. So right now, I want to open these altars for anyone who wants to come and dedicate their lives to God. For someone who's willing to step out by faith and say, I'll be the one. I'll be the one.